Okay. All right. So the title of my talk today is My Cancer, My Friend, Misfortune's Hidden Gems. So I wanted to start with a little introduction to a book that I'm writing about it. That's taking me a long time because I'll write for a while and then take a year off and then write some more. But the beginning and the end are very set. So this is the preface to that book. She came as an uninvited guest. She brought with her the unknown, discomfort, fear, panic, despair. I did not welcome her, but she came in and made herself at home regardless. I raged against her presence. I had done nothing to deserve this misfortune. Why was she here? Why? In time, though, I began to see she truly meant me no harm. She herself was sorry to be as she was. There was a sadness about her, but this was her nature, this strange and inexplicable multiplying of cells that worked against the healthy functioning of my body. She could do nothing to change who and how she was. She was simply following her destiny. I came to see her as I would an out-of-control teenager. Did she really enjoy wreaking havoc, causing all the destruction and misery she did? Or was she simply lost, afraid, alone, misunderstood? Did she not secretly yearn for, as did I, a return to balance? Was it helpful to scream and yell, to push back, to scold and admonish? Perhaps instead there was a way I could guide her, a way we could work together to bring her back to harmony, a way to put us together on a healthier path. She was, after all, a part of me, and therefore deserved all my love and the deepest respect. Perhaps if I treated her with the utmost care and tenderness, perhaps if I listened, perhaps she had wisdom for me. So when I first put this talk together, it was simply called 10 Lessons I Learned from Cancer and How It Deepened My Spiritual Path. But as I started working on it more, I came up with this phrase, my cancer, my friend, which was really inspired by the Buddhist saying, my enemy, my teacher. So, because it's kind of like that, you know, when we're faced with some kind of adversity, illness, or whatever, misfortune might come our way, we tend to think of it as the enemy. And then, if we're fortunate, we see that there's actually a lot of gifts within that, a lot of rich growth that happens, compassion that gets raised, different kinds of gifts that come our way, learning, all kinds of things that happen during a time of challenge that we might not see if we're busy perceiving that as the enemy. And this certainly happened to me in my journey with cancer. And really, over time, what I wrote in that preface to the book, that's exactly what happened, not after the fact, but during my treatment for cancer. I wanted to be in a peaceful mode throughout. I did have some days of raging for sure, and certainly some time of confusion, but I was able to enter into this kind of peaceful place of just accepting what was, and a lot of amazing things really happened, many of which I've spoken about to you before, and some of which I'll talk about again today. So I got to hear the Dalai Lama speak one time, and if you ever get the chance to do that in person, I highly recommend it. I was in a huge, big amphitheater way up in the top, and I was wondering why I was even there. I could watch him on TV or something like that. But literally, the minute he walked into the room, I started crying. And it's not because I had some, you know, idolization going on of him or that it had been some lifelong dream or anything like that. I was totally caught off guard. But he just is such a powerful presence and such a joy and pleasure to watch that I really recommend that. And he was talking about living nonviolence and, you know, peacefully in a violent age, and how do we do that? And he talked a lot about loving kindness, which is the center of Buddhism, and that is what we were all here to do, is to walk in loving kindness, and that the key to doing that was compassion. So how do we practice compassion? That's the big question. And someone asked him at the end about this phrase, this Buddhist phrase, my enemy, my teacher, and what that means. And he said, so the people in our lives that support us, our family, our friends, the people who make life easy for us, that's a beautiful thing. But we don't have to practice compassion there because it comes naturally. It's easy to have that kind of mode about us with those people. But the people that make our life difficult, the challenges in our life, that's where we get to practice compassion. And so he was saying that this is extremely important because without those people or those situations, we would have no practice time. And that practice time is essential to really learning how to walk in loving kindness. I see some faces that are like, So it's not an easy thing to do, but even if we just try to bring that phrase to mind, my enemy, my teacher, or my cancer, my friend, my illness, my friend, my difficult spouse, my friend, whatever it is, if we bring that to mind, it will maybe get us to shift a little bit. And in fact, this afternoon, that's a lot of what we're going to be doing, is how do I make that shift? How do I, it's great after the fact to be able to see the gifts within something, but what we want to do is learn how to actually do that at the time and to really let go of all of the things that are blocking our way and keeping us from welcoming life, all of it, because it does come with challenges, for sure. So the song that I sang, the traditional words to the first verse are, the water is wide, I can't cross over, which is often how we see things. Something happens and we're like, I can't do this. And neither have I wings to fly. Give me a boat that can carry two, and both shall row, my love and I. And I don't know the origins. I don't know if that was a love song or something else, but I see it in a very metaphysical way that's like, help me, Jesus, or whatever we want to, you know, however we say it. Let me be in the divine God, help me clear my way and carry me across this thing. So I rewrote the second verse, to though the water is wide, I shall cross o'er, for I have found new wings to fly. Come take my hand, we will travel on till journey's end, my love and I. So this is more of kind of the unity way, right, where we're going to co-create and step into something that's bigger than what we were before, that we recognize that we can grow wings to face any kind of challenge, and that if we step into this path of divinity, we can find our way across the most difficult of challenges. And I love those stories of human beings just facing amazing conditions and rising above and having joy in their hearts. So I often use this phrase, misfortune's grace. And a lot of amazing moments of grace happened for me during my cancer treatment. And I know I've shared some of these with you before, but I want to just touch on a couple of them. And one of them was this, I wasn't in a bad space really too often after the initial shock and, you know, adjustment. But I did have one day in particular where I woke up and people had come and rehabbed my whole house. I think I've talked with you about that. It was just this amazing coming together of people just coming out of the woodwork wanting to help me. And I was in that house, but it wasn't finished. The kitchen wasn't quite working. The kitchen floor hadn't been laid. There were boxes of stuff that had been moved from my old place all over the living room. And I had a big slice down my belly and was in chemo treatment. So, you know, I wasn't very functional, mentally or physically. And I just woke up thinking, you know, this is so unfair. What did I do to deserve this? And I'd always taken care of myself. I felt like I had faced, you know, done a lot of emotional work and tried to practice loving kindness and never smoked, was never overweight, always exercised, was vegetarian, you know, all these things. Why do I have ovarian cancer, you know? And so I was really angry at God and raging. That was my day of raging, why me? And feeling like, who am I to deserve all this misfortune? So a few days later, I was staying with a friend and she was reading the newspaper, and there was this man at our church, the Unity Church in Lawrence. His name was Earl. He was a veteran, I believe, and I think he was diabetic. So he was a little overweight and he had lost one of his legs from the knee down. So he was in a wheelchair, maybe both legs from the knee down. But he always had, so he was living in adverse conditions, but he always had this great smile. And he was always in the most beautiful kind of space. And I did not know him well, but I always went up to him to say hello because he was just such a wonderful person to be around. And so I was with this friend and she was reading the newspaper and she says, Cindy, oh my gosh, Earl died. So I went by her side and she was reading the obituary to me out loud. And she's reading about his life, and then at the end it said, in lieu of flowers, please donate to the Cindy Novello Recovery Fund. Which didn't exist, right? He just created it. Yeah, and I just was like, oh my gosh, I didn't know this person that well. And I knew he had a lot of other interests, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, there's wars going on, there's refugees, there's this, there's that, there's the other, and he picked me. And I was just like, overcome with this feeling of grace, and who am I to deserve all this grace? And it was at that moment, I actually get chills just even remembering. It was at that moment that I thought, oh my gosh, 3 days ago, I was saying, who am I to deserve all this misfortune? So it's true, something happened, but you know, the truth is a lot of it is simply our perspective. We tend to focus on what is negative. And our brains are wired that way, actually. They're wired to look at the problems and then figure out the solutions. So when we can bring that to mind and recognize that that's how our brain is wired, we can rewire our brains, but it takes a lot of practice and a lot of, you know, exercising our mind to see things in a different way. So again, that's a lot of what we'll be doing this afternoon, is learning some techniques for doing that. There's also this wonderful story, I don't know if I've told it here before, but it's a Chinese like fable, I guess, or something. There is a, a farmer who, this is some years ago, and he had a horse that he used to work his fields, and the horse disappeared, ran off. So the villagers all came to him and said, oh my gosh, what misfortune. We are so sorry. He's like, who knows? Maybe good, maybe bad. So the next day his son went out to find the horse, and ended up finding three more horses, wild horses, that he brought back with him. So then the villagers all came around and said, oh my gosh, you're so lucky. The farmer said, maybe it's good, maybe not. The next day, his son is breaking in one of the wild horses and fell off and broke his leg. And again, he needed his son to work his farm. So the villagers all came and said, oh my gosh, we're so sorry, that's so unfortunate. He said, maybe good, maybe bad. The next day, the army came around to conscript all the able young men to take them to war, and they couldn't take the son because he had a broken leg. So the villagers came and said, oh my gosh, that's so wonderful, what good fortune. He said, maybe good, maybe bad, etc. And it goes on. So this story teaches us a lot of things. We think something is either good or bad, and we get very attached to that particular notion of our story, whatever it is, when in fact we don't know. It could be that good fortune comes from it, but even if good fortune comes, it will be temporary, because all things are temporary in this life. Likewise with the bad, when something bad happens, we think, oh my gosh, this is the end, this is it. But we actually don't know the whole story. We also don't know our individual situation, what is happening there, how that might ripple out and affect others, both for positive or negative. So again, we can't see that whole big picture. So all of this teaches us to come into the moment and just trust what's happening in the moment. And, you know, be a little patient and accepting of what is going on. So, and another thing that really is amazing that happens from these things, these challenges that we face, anytime we face a new challenge, anytime we have suffering in our lives, our compassion for others who may be in that situation is automatically boosted. So we might work really hard at raising compassion or practicing compassion, but it's actually pretty difficult to do for someone who's in a very different situation from us. It's very hard. We can. Some people, like the Dalai Lama, manage to do it for all people no matter what. But most of us, it's difficult. But when we are faced with suffering, suddenly it's like, oh my gosh, now I get it. I feel so much for this other person who's going through that. So it certainly happened to me with cancer. It happened to me when my job at a university was eliminated overnight. I was not expecting that. I had a good position, and it was, you know, I'd always gotten great reviews. We knew the university was in trouble, I mean, that they were going to be cutting, but we'd never expected it to happen with my position. And this is in, you know, February of 2009. It's happening everywhere. I was hearing about it in the news all over the place. But I didn't get it until the next day when I'm standing in my living room going, oh my gosh, this is how people lose their houses. You lose your whole income. You can't pay your mortgage. So thankfully that didn't happen to me. But it happens to a lot of people. And I just suddenly was like, oh, this is what all the uproar is about. This is a really, really difficult thing. So each of these things, I try to look at them and see what are the, you know, the overall arching lessons. And one of them for me a big one, was not to pass judgment. That means don't pass judgment on what's happening to me, but it also means don't pass judgment on what's happening to another person, or even on how that person is acting. I might be at the grocery store and the person behind the counter is irritable and treating me what seems to be very unfairly. Maybe she's a grumpy person in general, but even if that's true, there's a reason for that. Something's going on in her life. But maybe just that morning, her husband left her and she has 3 children and she doesn't know how she's going to feed them. Or maybe she just learned she has a very, you know, challenging health issue, or who knows? We don't know what's going on with that person. So it's an excellent time to practice compassion regardless, and loving kindness regardless of what we think. And of course, I've been on the other end of that. In fact, this happened this last week. I'm like getting very upset with someone at my cable company, right, about something. And I didn't treat her particularly well. Finally, I was like, well, I don't understand, and I'm going to go into the office and, you know, click. And I was like, whoa, Cindy, right? And of course, I was stressed about some other things. It wasn't just because of the cable bill, you know. I was stressed about some other things. And I just hoped that after the fact, you know, of course, immediately I wanted to call her up and say, I'm so sorry that was so unfair to mistreat you that way. It's not, you know, you didn't do that. And in fact, the error was mine, I discovered later, not the cable companies. So then I felt doubly bad. But I hoped that she knew that, you know, that it wasn't about her, and, you know, that I was sending her my forgiveness over the airwaves. But it's very important to remember just not to pass judgment on others or situations, because we don't know the full story. And it's certainly a good thing to remember right now with all that's going on in our country politically. We don't know the full story. And the other thing that's really, really valuable to remember here is that there is hope in hard times. Not in spite of hard times, but in hard times. And if we remember that, then we can start looking for it and mining that. In every single situation, there's grace and abundance. We just have to dig a little deeper sometimes. And I think she mentioned in my introduction that I'm doing life coaching now. I just started doing that about 6 months ago, I think. I've never even made an official announcement about it, but kind of people finding out here and there different ways. And that's really the main focus for me, too, of the life coaching, is helping people see things in a different way and finding the beauty within misfortune and in every moment, really. So I like to tell this other story about this amazing human being named Ishmael Beya. He was a boy soldier in Sierra Leone, and I got to hear him speak one time and had a question and answer afterwards. And this is his primary work now. He goes around talking to world leaders about that particular situation and how what we might do to alleviate it, and just bringing consciousness to the fact that is continuing to happen in different countries. And someone asked him at the end, so he'd led a very horrific life, you know, in his formative years in particular, and he had ended up in the United States and went to Oberlin College and wrote a book about his experience called A Long Way Gone, Memoirs of a Boy Soldier. And so in this question and answer period, somebody asked him, he has this man has this amazing smile, like really radiant, you can just see joy from the inside out. And someone asked him how he could be so joyful when his life had been so horrific. And he said, every day I wake up so thankful to be alive. Every day I'm so happy to be alive. So that's a big one. You know, when we are constantly focused on, I don't know, I've got a flat tire, I'm driving a Mercedes to a really good job, but I've got a flat tire, so my life sucks, right? Or whatever. Or we can't find the lid to our Tupperware. What, you know, it's just a lot of different things. We're always griping about something. And it's very interesting because in this country where we are so incredibly rich, I've lived in a lot of places, and I find people more discontent and unsatisfied and unhappy about their lives here than any place else I've ever lived. So that's also something to remember, you know? And I like to tell people too, you know, if we are complaining, our mind has a bunch of complaints, right off the bat, we have something to be really grateful for because we are alive and we're thinking, right? If we weren't, we wouldn't be able to have those. So there's many other things I could talk about on this subject, but I'm gonna close here in just a bit. I just wanted to mention one other kind of primary topic, which is, my title for it is Fear is a Friend Who's Misunderstood, which is a line from a John Mayer song that I just love. So obviously, when these things happen to us, we can use cancer as an example. There's a lot of things to fear. First of all, I was afraid I might die. And my primary fear about that was not even the end of my own life, but leaving my children who are grown and, you know, would be fine, but still leaving them without a mother. And, you know, I feared losing my hair, which turned out to be totally fine. I actually recommend it. You should try going bald. Everybody should try it once. Makes you brave. Yeah, there you go. See, he's like, yay. wasn't near as bad as I expected. But the truth is, and even the dying part, you know, yes, cancer is one in particular that everybody's afraid you're going to die, or the person that has been diagnosed is going to die. But actually, lots of people live with cancer, or, you know, are cured from cancer now. It's kind of carries this stigma from 20 years ago or 30 years ago when it was a very different thing. And you could die, but you could also die tomorrow anyway from something else. So that's this kind of false perception that we have that somehow, you know, unless we've been diagnosed with something, we're not going to die, when in fact is we don't know what's, we could get hit by a bus tomorrow. We don't know. So we might as well just let go of the fear and live in happiness. And I'm sure you've heard this acronym for FEAR, false evidence appearing real. So, and again, you know, in the workshop we work with these things of just, you know, the stories that we tell and how we are very, you know, perceiving things in a certain way when in fact we could perceive them in a very, very different kind of way. So I'm just going to close on that note, and we're going to do a meditation that's going to kind of take us there. So I'm going to get set up for some music that I'm going to play that's going to allow you to just kind of go more deeply into it. But while you're getting settled there, you can go ahead and start getting settled. I want you to bring to mind something in your life right now that's a challenge, and we'll kind of use that for this meditation. I'm sure it shouldn't be too hard to come up with something. And it can be something small or something big. It doesn't matter.